Thank you for inviting me. I didn't know about this science cafe, but it's really exhilarating to know that it exists and to see so many people who are curious about science. And the depth of your curiosity must be pretty substantial. Otherwise, you'd be at a pool or at the beach on a day like this instead of coming to a lecture. But I'm going to talk about communicating science in a polluted science communication environment, and that's a lot of abstractions. But I'm not going to just start by trying to tell you what that is. I'm just going to show you by going to some data, and once we've looked at it, I think you'll understand what it is I'm talking about. And besides, it's more interesting, I think, to look at data. So I'm going to go through three studies and maybe pause in between them. We can discuss them. The first one, you probably can't see that, it's on motivated numeracy. Two concepts in there, that the motivated reasoning is the tendency of people to assess information in selective ways that reflect some goal or interest they have that's independent of the truth, like fitting into their social group. Numeracy is an aptitude, not so much to be able to do math proficiently, but to be able to reason with quantitative information and draw appropriate inferences from data. And in fact, in this experiment, we wanted people to draw inferences or tell us what inferences data supported. And we said, look at an experiment that was done on a new form of skin cream to treat skin rashes. Because, you know, the scientists are always doing great things like that. But sometimes the rash goes away by itself. Sometimes, I guess, the skin cream makes people's face fall off or something like that. So you have to do an experiment to see if it really works and if it's safe. And so we say, here are the results of the experiment. Right? How many people got better, how many got worse in the two groups, the treatment group who got the skin cream, and then in the control group. And you're probably, if you can see the numbers anyway, getting instantly the right answer. People who used the skin cream were more likely to get worse than those who didn't. But people actually have a hard time understanding the 2x2 contingency table. It's not any easier when you don't use the table. I mean, actually, it gets harder. But people have a heuristic. They say, well, if you look at the people who used the skin cream, right, 223 got better, only 75 got worse. So it must be making them better. Right? And then their friend comes to them and says, you idiot, you have to look at the control group too. See, 223 people in the treatment group got better, only 107 did in the control. It works. And even that isn't enough, right? The reason it's in a 2x2 table, you have to use all of this information to figure out what the impact is of the intervention, the treatment. You want to know the ratio of cases where you observe a good result versus the bad result, conditional on being assigned either to the treatment or the control. So people in the treatment group, 223 got better, 75 got worse, they're about three times more likely to get better than worse. But if you look at the control group, 107 got better, 21 got worse, you're five times likely to get better than to get worse in the control group. So actually the right answer is people who use the skin cream more likely to get worse than those who didn't. And we also change the heading. So half the subjects are seeing the information, which if they were interpreting it properly, would suggest that the skin cream is working, and half are seeing information which, if it's interpreted correctly, suggests that it's not working. And this is the raw data here. You can see how many are getting it incorrect or correct. That's just a locally weighted regression line, sort of gives you a running tally of the proportion of people who are getting it right relative to the score on the numeracy test, which has 9 items in it. So you can see that people who are more numerate, they're more likely to get it right. And if I put if I model the data, the lines are just the confidence intervals, you can see it's pretty hard. Right? At the 50th percentile in numeracy, only 30% likelihood that you're going to get it right. That's just equivalent to saying that 70% of the people in the general population are going to get it wrong. Right? It's even more than 50%. Right? They do worse than guessing, because with this sort of problem, it's a good test problem. Unless you really know what the right answer is, the answer that's wrong looks like it's the right answer. So the people aren't guessing, they're just getting the wrong answer. And you have to be at the 95th percentile, basically, of numeracy before you even have a 75% chance of getting it right. So it's a pretty hard test. But actually, there's more to the study I didn't tell you about. There's another group that we asked to assess the results of an experiment on gun control. And it's the same numbers, right? But we tell them that, well, social scientists were comparing the jurisdictions that banned carrying a concealed gun in public and those that allowed it to see whether crime was going up when people were allowed to carry the concealed handguns, or was it instead going down because maybe they could police things themselves, or there'd be some kind of deterrent effect if you think maybe people around here are packing heat or so forth. And we used exactly the same numbers, right, for that. And so really there are four conditions. We have the skin cream and the guns, and each one, half the people are seeing the information that suggests that the intervention or treatment, the skin cream or the law banning guns worked, and half were seeing information which, if they properly construed, suggests it's not working. And I've already showed you the raw data in the skin treatment version. This is what we get with the gun ban. It looks a little noisier, and something is going on. And what's going on is this, partisanship. If you look at the skin treatment subjects, they were more likely to get the answer right as their numeracy increased, just as you expected. And it didn't matter what their political views were. And this is consistent with ordinary experience, because we know liberals and conservatives basically both have the same kind of clear complexions. With the gun ban, though, something pretty odd is happening. See, if you properly interpret the information as a highly numerate subject and it supports the position that's associated with your political outlooks, then you're more likely to get it right than the low numeracy people. Right? So if the data properly interpreted shows that crime is decreasing with the ban on the handguns, that's the liberal position. The more liberal subjects are getting that right as their numeracy increases. Or if you're a conservative and you got the information that suggests crime is increasing, again, at least if you were highly numerate, then you were likely to get it right. But when the information properly interpreted was actually contrary to the position associated with the political ideology of the subjects, the high numeracy subjects, they weren't really doing any better than the low numeracy ones. And we can try to figure out or discipline some of the inferences here. We can fit a model. I know you can't see that, but even if you could, if somebody comes along and tries, just shows you this kind of regression model, maybe they put three asterisks after the coefficients to show you that they had p less than 0.001, you should demand your money back, right? And so today you could demand your money back. I don't know how much value that would be, but really, even if you understand how to interpret this kind of information, you still aren't going to be able to understand what the practical effect of it is just from the information that's in the table. You need some way of demonstrating in a graphic kind of presentation what the effects are. You tell me if this works, but I'm just doing a Monte Carlo simulation. You take any of the numbers that for the different parameters in the model. I want to have a conservative Republican, right, who has a low numeracy in the skin treatment condition, and in a Monte Carlo simulation, maybe you know how this works. You can always compute what the probability is from the model, but the parameters, they have a little bit of error in them, right? So you do it with a kind of shaky hand. You add a little bit of random number that is corresponds to the error in the parameter. So it's going to be somewhere around what the number would be if you just were to compute it manually. And you do that once, and then you do it again, and again and again and again, about 1,000 times, and you can see what the entire probability density distribution is associated with that model, given those kinds of variables. This is what Nate Silver does to figure out who's going to win the election, and I guess that doesn't make you have more confidence in what I'm doing. But here you can say, okay, so you can put it in these terms. The low numeracy Republican, about 25% chance that he or she's going to get it right, plus or minus 10. Same thing for somebody who's a low numeracy person who has the liberal outlooks. They're a little more likely to get it right if the information suggested that the rash would decrease, and maybe a little bit of confirmation bias or something like that. People think the scientists know what they're doing, but it's not very big. If you look at the high numeracy subjects in the skin treatment condition, they're all doing the same and doing much better, about 70% likely to get it right than the low numeracy subjects. Now we look at the gun ban, you start to see the polarization. Right? This is the low numeracy group and crime increases, and so the conservatives are a little bit more likely to get it right. That's what the conservative expect to happen, not the low numeracy liberal. And same thing with the high numeracy, right? Look at the crime decrease condition. You might be noticing this, that in any given condition, right, crime decreases for low numeracy, crime decreases for high numeracy, the gap between the likelihood of the subjects getting it right is bigger for the people who are high in numeracy. Right? And in fact, the person who's low in numeracy is 25 percentage points more likely to get the right answer if the information in the table corresponds to that person's political outlooks. But in the high numeracy condition, the high numeracy subjects, 46 percentage points more likely to get the right answer if the information in the table is consistent with their ideology than if it's inconsistent. And so the conservative or the high numeracy subjects, they're not missing the right answer, right, when it's consistent with their ideology, where some of the low numeracy people are. And then if the information isn't consistent with their ideology, they figure out some way to kind of pry open the logic trap with some kind of confabulatory answer, right, about why the experiment's not very good. But they only do that if they don't want to accept the inference that the study would otherwise support. Now, I'll stop in a second, we can talk about it, but I'll tell you what the background is behind this. See, this is a part of a research program designed to test what you might call the bounded rationality thesis. Right? The idea is that you see these kinds of conflicts, polarizing conflicts over empirical data or facts, because the public isn't very good at understanding scientific information. Right? They don't think the way that scientists do. Right? Scientists are very conscious, deliberate, analytical, right? The slow kind of reasoning, Daniel Kahneman would call it, and that is conducive to getting the right answer, whereas the members of the public, they think in rapid, intuitive, emotionally driven ways. Right? And so if they see some kind of dramatic display of the harm that can be caused by some behavior, right? They see that the airplane fuselage sticking out of the skyscraper and it's all on fire. That makes a much bigger impression on them, and they overestimate that risk relative to ones that might actually be more dangerous for them, but that are associated with less emotionally compelling images, right, like the polar bear floating on the ice or something like that. Not a big deal. He'll just get a Coca-Cola when he gets around the corner or something like this. And you might think, well, that sounds like a good theory. And it is a good theory because these are real mechanisms of cognition with respect to risk. Maybe they apply here. But you see, there are more plausible kinds of theories about why people do what they do than are actually true. So you want to test the theory, not just say, well, it's plausible that it's right, and see if it's really right. And so you can do that by taking a large sample of the general public, figuring out what they think the risk are of something like climate change, because what I call the bounded rationality theory, it makes a prediction about what we're going to see. And if the reason that the average person isn't as concerned about climate change, say, as the scientists are, is that the average person in the public doesn't think the way that scientists do, well, then as that person's capacity to understand scientific information gets better, that person ought to be approaching, right, what the scientists think is right. And the gap between the people of different cultural outlooks or political outlooks, it ought to be narrowing. Like, the people who are good at understanding science, well, they're going to go with the evidence. Whereas the people who aren't very good at it, right, they're going to have to go with their gut, and that's filled with crap, like, well, what do people like me believe, right? And so you ought to see them converging as they get more adept at using the kind of reasoning that the scientists do, system two, as opposed to the rapid system one kind of information processing. And because one group at least is moving up, the trend for the population as a whole, it ought to be going up as people become more proficient at understanding science. That's the prediction I associate with the bounded rationality thesis. But this is what we actually see, right, that there's not any impact at the population level on the perception of the risk of climate change as people become better able to comprehend science. But that actually is pretty misleading, because the comprehension of science has a big impact, it turns out, on what people think the perception of what people think the risk of climate change is. But what impact it has depends on people's ideologies. Right? So as liberals become more proficient in understanding science, they're more likely to see climate change as a big risk. But as conservatives become more proficient at understanding science, they become less likely to believe that there's a serious risk. Right? And this is a robust finding. I mean, I was talking about what they saw the risks of climate change as being. You can ask them a more specific question. Right? Is climate change happening? Are humans responsible for it? You get the same kind of perverse effect from science comprehension. You can get the same perverse effect when you use the actively open-minded thinking scale to assess their reasoning. This is supposed to be a disposition to re-examine your preconceptions in light of evidence, but it's not working, at least when people are thinking about these kinds of risks. The cognitive reflection test, which is kind of like the gold standard for assessing whether people use system one or system two reasoning. Other kinds of risks that are like this, like the gun ownership, right, same kind of effect with the polarization increasing as people become better at comprehending science. Fracking, right? So this is what we're seeing. It's not what the bounded rationality theory would predict. Right, so we're getting, you have less information, less reason to credit that theory if you see this. It almost looks like people are using their capacity to understand the science to reinforce their belief in the position that's associated with their group, right? And that's what this experiment was for. We saw in the survey data that you have this perverse effect, so you say, well, let's look at whether people, when they're actually understanding the information, are using their proficiency in understanding science, and you can have the different measures of that to actually fit the information to what is associated with their group. She thinks that's a horrible thing, I guess. Go ahead.
They don't seem to be using their abilities.
Well, you know, that's a good point. So, I mean, what's going on here? You say they're not using their science comprehension ability. You know, it depends. Well, we're not really sure. You'd have to do more experiments to see what's going on. I mean, I said, well, they're using it to get the right answer when the right answer is hard to understand but it's consistent with their ideology, and they're using their proficiency to explain away the information when it doesn't cohere with their ideology. Do you have a different idea about what's happening?
No, I'm just wondering that. Yeah.
Well, I understood you to say, well, they're not using it. You see, another possibility is that the siren song of politically gratifying kinds of results is actually preempting them from using their ability to understand the quantitative information better, right? That they how do you know you got a math problem right? You get this kind of feeling, well, that seems right. And if you're better at math, well, then you're more likely to get that feeling. And when the answer is wrong, but once you get it right, you kind of know you've got it right. Well, here you see that I showed you there was a heuristic way to understand the information in the table. I just look at the ratio, just look at the numbers of people who got better and got worse. That's what everybody does at first. But if you're high in numeracy, you get this kind of nagging feeling. That doesn't seem quite right. Let me think about this some more. But if it's something that is testing your position on some issue that has this kind of relationship to your identity, politically defined, we can define it in other ways too, but if this is part of your group membership, then you get this gratifying sense that the answer is right when it's consistent with your ideology. Right? And you confuse that for the kind of intuition you would have, the kind of sense that it's right, that you use to determine whether you've done enough calculating with the... I don't know, it's one of those two, right? But in any case, we're seeing that there's a kind of selectivity to the use of the greater comprehension of science, and we get these kinds of results. This is clearly not right, I think, on the basis of the kinds of studies I've been showing you. If anything, the problem here isn't that people aren't rational enough, it's that they're too rational. Right? They're too good at giving to information like that the effect that it really has in their everyday life. Right? So I'll stop in 1 second, I promise, although it could be a long second. What an individual thinks, say, about climate change doesn't have any effect on the climate. Otherwise, it wouldn't be quite so hot today. What they do as a consumer, I mean, their own carbon footprint is not going to be big enough to have an impact. As a voter, it's very unlikely that their vote is going to matter in an election anyway, even if it were the case that climate change was on the ballot or something like this. Any kind of mistake a person makes about science in those capacities doesn't increase the risk for her or anybody that she cares about. If, however, you make a mistake in the position that you take relative to the one in your peer group, you know, at this point, these kinds of positions have become like badges of membership and loyalty to the group, then you could be in trouble. Right? You know Bob Inglis was, he was a member of Congress, was the most conservative member of Congress, and he was from South Carolina. And he said, well, I think climate change is real, and I'm going to do something about it to protect my constituents. And they rewarded him by booting him out of office in a Republican primary. And you know, imagine you're Floyd the Barber down in the 5th District of North Carolina or South Carolina, and you're giving somebody the shave with the big straight razor, and on the way out you say to him, well, please sign my petition to save the polar bears. I mean, you'll be out of a job almost as quickly as Bob Inglis was. And you don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure out what position, well, what issues are like this and what position goes with your group. But if you are even more proficient in this kind of reasoning than most people are, why not use that capacity? Because it's actually benefiting you. Right? Now, if everybody does that at the same time, then we're screwed. Right? Because then diverse groups are less likely to converge on the right answer in democratic politics when the evidence suggests that they're really facing some real risk. But even that doesn't give any individual an incentive to think about the information in a different way. Right? So there's a kind of collective action problem. It's the tragedy of the science communication commons, I would say. Right, but now I'll stop. First, you have a question or comment?
I guess I was wondering, is there a test for bias for the types of questions you're asking? Because these are liberal issues. Is there a different set, for example, does it pay to stand up to the Russians? Or, you know, a bunch of things where there might be a different...
What do you think the answer is on the gun ownership?
Well, I guess it doesn't matter what I think, but is...
Well, no, but I'm trying to engage this point. You're saying, well, these are all liberal issues. I mean, the right answer on global warming is that it's real. It's more risky. What's the right answer on the gun ownership? I'm just, you know... Yeah?
No, for me, it looks like every ideology gets us away from logical thinking.
Yeah, well, you have to, you know, if you think that, if you believe your group's position is right, then you're only going to see the other group always getting it wrong, right? But, I mean, if we use the National Academy of Science reports to expert reports to tell us what the expert consensus is, that's a good benchmark, I suppose. On the gun ownership, they say you can't figure it out. Because the kinds of models, they look something like what I was using, are too kind of fragile, and they're not robust enough. You can just change multiple reasonable ways to specify the model of whether the gun possession is making crime go up or go down. And you can't settle that with the kinds of methods that that people have been using. So I don't know why the liberals go in that direction of fracking. I think they probably don't even have enough evidence to have an opinion. Nuclear power, I could have put that up there. That's the same kind of thing. I mean, it's an interesting question. Are these kinds of reasoning pathologies? And they are pathologies. They're not normal. More associated with people on the right or on the left? And I tend to think, well, they're actually distributed pretty evenly across the population, but people argue about that kind of thing. Yeah. You had a question in the back? Yeah. Yeah, it's cognitive dissonance. I say, well, this is an identity protective reasoning, I would call it. Right? That motivated reasoning, I told you, is when people have this incentive or disposition to credit information selectively in patterns that achieve some other goal than the truth. And here I'm saying the theory I would put on this is that they have a goal to maintain their good standing in the group on these issues that have come to be symbolized with the group membership. Right? And they probably would feel bad if they were to accept some information that was contrary to their group belief, because they would say, well, that means the people in my group are biased or something like that. But that's not the only kind of effect that they're trying to avoid by reasoning in this way. There's a chance that they're going to actually suffer a loss of standing, that they're going to be distrusted by other people who are part of their group if they adopt the wrong kind of collection of positions on this. That wouldn't be cognitive dissonance. So I think it's just a little bit more particular than that.
Well, I get a little nervous when I heard you use the word the truth, because members can lie. I'm not saying I don't believe in climate change. I'm not saying that. As a matter of fact, this Friday at Yale, they're going to have a sequel to Inconvenient Truth, and the public's invited. This is Friday, so people are interested in having it go. So outside of whatever might be.
Might be sold out. Sold out.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Check it anyway. Okay.
So outside of whatever my belief is, the thing is, numbers can lie, and I've certainly had experiences with many people who consider themselves scientific.
Yeah.
And I have seen them, based on whatever their beliefs are.
So that's a good question. Do these kind of mechanisms affect what scientists do?
Scientists,
right? That would be a good question, too.
Scientists are very, very effective. If they have a particular belief, they may not see the other.
It's possible,
either. So I think truth is a tough thing, and I think a lot of stuff deals with illusion and our illusions.
Yeah.
It's much more complicated than that. I appreciate your attempt at it.
Yeah.
I have some science tricks I do with adults and children, where intuitively, when they look at it, many adults, they'll believe one thing is going to happen, and then they're shocked when this other thing happens, because even though they've had many, many years of experience, it doesn't matter how old they are, they still cannot perceive what could actually be going on if they see it happen.
Uh-huh. Yeah, well, that was what I was attempting to some degree, too, with the covariance problem, yeah?
Since your topic is on science communications, please explain these graphs.
Okay, so here, well, I thought that you had before I showed this graph. But you see here on the x-axis, we have the science comprehension measured with a test that the National Science Foundation uses. On the x, the perceived risk. And you can see that the two groups, the blue and the red, they're going in opposite directions.
Blue and red.
Blue, that's that's Connecticut. You know, red is South Carolina, right? And so
you've kept on the same liberal, Republican, conservative, although you use different text there.
Well, the text. It's below average or above average on the scale that I'm using to measure whether people are to the left or the right. Right. So if you're above average on the scale, that means you have a right wing or a conservative orientation. If you're on the left hand side of the mean, then you have the right. So that's the.
All nine graphs, blue is.
Yeah. Yeah. And you can see it. There's actually. I don't have room for orders of magnitude, but there are order of magnitude more issues where you don't see this kind of perverse effect. first of all, polarization over facts by people who have different political orientations, actually then getting worse as their science comprehension goes up, then actually look like the three I put at the top. Right? Most of the time, people are that they're converging on the best answer. It's not because they know a lot of science, but because they're immersed in networks of people who are going to be basically able to orient them with respect to the kind of science issues that matter in their life. But on these kinds of issues, you see this kind of entanglement of people's identity with positions on contested facts. And at that point, they have an incentive to use their reason not to get the truth, but to fit the evidence to their identity. Or you could say, and I think maybe this is right, that their reasoning is disabled by those kinds of meanings that entangle the positions with their identities. And they don't do as well. They do much worse than you would expect people who are science literate to do. Right? Those meanings that put people on of different ideologies, or we can measure this in other ways too, religion, cultural outlooks, at odds with each other, they're a kind of pollution in the science communication environment.
The right? Bottom six items.
Yeah.
Have a lot more basis for what the truth is than the top three. I think the top three are a lot.
It's possible, but I think that the perception that things are complicated often is connected to exactly the phenomenon I'm talking about. I don't know, is global warming the basis for that less secure than nanotechnology? Nobody's ever really, I don't know, GM foods or high voltage power lines. In England, they actually have the kind of dispute that I'm describing on the high voltage power lines. And they would say, well, it's not very settled, not because they know the science, but because they can see one group in society arguing with another about it. And they go, well, there must be a debate.
I would bet if you look at the ratio of favorable and unfavorable publications on those bottom six, it's much more solidified than on those top.
Really? So on climate change, you haven't heard that 97% of scientists agree that this is like a social marketing campaign. It's kind of like a bumper sticker.
Publications.
Yeah, publications is how that was derived.
You can get the publications on the internet, and if people weigh those, you'll see a lot I don't agree with them, but I think that's what you're getting into. Another question. What's this numeracy test that you mentioned earlier?
Well, so it's a measure, again, not so much of math ability. If you have a sixth grade education, you should be able to do the math, but a measure of how well people can use quantitative information when they reason and draw appropriate inferences. And so you have things like conditional probability problems. Right? You have the covariance problem could be in a battery like that. Right? So how good are people at reasoning with...
Was each dot in person? One dot in the top category.
Was each dot? You mean when I showed you the raw data?
First graph when you had numeracy on the bottom, and you had dots down.
Yeah, so those are observations, also known as people, right? And each one was one person, so there's about 2,000 people, right? So if you in the sample, actually about 500 for the skin cream.
One person.
No, it is one person. Why not? One person, a dot is one person, right? And as you get to, not too many people are getting a perfect score, right? As you can see that most people there's a greater concentration of the dots, the people at the lower parts of the scale are getting it wrong. As they get better at reasoning, it goes up. It's a little bit hard to see it because it's 500, so it's kind of overplotted. So it's helpful to have the regression line. Now, here's the thing. Do you want me to go on and talk about, I think at most one more study at this point,
yes.
But that's okay, because it actually is, in a way, the perfect bookend for this. Well, we can see how far we get. I think the value of discussion is pretty high, but here I'm going to tell you about science curiosity, something that I think you have a lot of if you're here today. All right, so we have a project. It's a evidence-based science filmmaking project. And the idea is to see if the kinds of methods that I'm talking about here, the empirical methods, can be integrated into the making of science documentaries in a way that would advance the craft of science filmmaking. And you see that the science documentary producers, they want to make their movies as engaging and appealing as possible. And if you're trying to assess how they're doing that, you've got to have some measure of the kind of enjoyment that people get out of science in general. Again, the general population, believe it or not, not everybody loves science. And so you don't want to have a sample that can't distinguish between the people who do like it and the people who don't, because you're trying to give information to the science documentary producer about how to make a better movie. But if your sample is a general population one, then the answer is going to be, well, have more explosions and more frontal nudity, or something like this. You want to have a measure of the people who like science, because they're the ones who you're trying to engage with. So you need some kind of curiosity measure. And this, we went to Kmart for psychometric measures, and this is what they're selling us. This is a typical state-of-the-art science curiosity. Agree or disagree? I'm curious about the world in which we live. No. I find it boring to hear about new ideas. Yeah, that's me. You know, this is kind of you're bombarded. 40, 50 questions like this, it's pretty obvious to you what is being measured here and what you should say to meet the expectations in society or of the experimenter, right? You always get very skewed results, and they don't predict what they're supposed to predict. So we had to develop another one, and you can't see these, but this is just basically, it looks like a consumer marketing survey to people. We said, what kinds of topics do you like to talk about with your friends and so forth? Crime, education, government, politics, sports, religion. Well, science is in there, right? But they're getting the science measure. It's on its own. Each item's on its own screen. They're never going to figure out, you see, that what we're interested in is how much they like science. But even better, we have some objective measures, right? Not just self-report. At about 15 minutes into the study, they're already getting kind of tired of it. We say, well, we want you to read an article that you think is interesting. We'll ask you some questions about it. And they're not really eager to do reading, but they have a kind of menus here. Entertainment stories, science stories, sports, or finance. And say, you pick the category, and we'll take one of the stories that's being featured in that category and give it to you. So pick something you're interested in. And if they pick science, well, then you got pretty good reason to believe that they like science, right? And this turns out to be a really nice measure. It has all kinds of good properties, including that it's normally distributed, that the measurement precision is really good, like LSAT or SAT quality validity and reliability in the measure. So it's really, it's picking out the differences in people's assessment of science and whether they like it or not, even at the extremes in the population. So it's a good scale. And then we show people science videos. We're trying to validate the measure. It's measuring something. Is it really measuring whether people like these kinds of science documentaries? I could go on for at least an hour about why this was a really interesting clip from Your Inner Fish. Should people watch Your Inner Fish? It's a really good program on evolution. This is how your uncle, the monkey, got color vision. And we have measures then of how engaged people were by the information in relation to their science curiosity as we measure it. And the engagement index is kind of a composite of things like how many minutes did you watch? Right? They could watch for 15 minutes or they could watch 30 seconds, right, and hope that the next thing's more interesting to them. The probability that they're going to go through the procedure we had to get the whole video, right, so somebody's going to give us the information necessary to send the video to them, that's evincing a kind of interest in science, and it's predicted very well by the science curiosity scale. We validate it, too. Everybody's concerned about replication, so we have two more videos and get the same kind of relationship. Now, some people wondered if the people who are scoring high on what we call science curiosity, maybe they're just OCD, and they would watch anything, like the paint drying or something like that. So we tried to find the paint drying equivalent, for people who are interested in science. The Daily Hollywood Rundown, how many of you watch that? And so we figured there's no way that people who are interested in science are going to be more likely than the average person in the population to like that show. And we look at it and find that it's essentially orthogonal to science interests. We felt good about that. Otherwise, I'd throw the whole thing away. Now, here's the surprising part about it. Surprised me, at least. I've already shown you this kind of information, right? That people polarize as they become more proficient in understanding science on these issues like global warming and fracking. That doesn't happen with science curiosity. And there's still a difference between the Republicans and the Democrats, but they're tending in the same direction. And in fact, among the people who are high in science curiosity, you don't see that perverse effect of greater polarization associated with the higher science comprehension. It's canceling it out. And so we're trying to figure out, why would this be? And maybe the answer we thought was, well, people who have a partisan identity, if they're science curious, they're more likely to expose themselves to information that's contrary to their predispositions. Right? It's part of the same pathology that I'm describing, this identity protective reasoning, to prefer information that's consistent with your views rather than information that's inconsistent. Right? So we wanted to do an experiment to see if the people who are curious, maybe they're more kind of even-handed in the kind of information that they're looking at, so they're not as biased in that way. And in this experiment, again, we asked them to pick between two news stories. We give them the headline. Pick either one, the one that's most interesting to you, and we'll ask you some questions about it. And then we had two conditions. The news stories, if you looked at the headlines, they varied in two ways. One was whether they would be more congenial to a climate change believer versus a climate change skeptic. And the other difference was whether the information was unsurprising, we already knew that, right, or surprising. So, see, scientists find still more evidence linking global warming to extreme weather. Well, that's consistent with what the climate change believer believes, and it's unsurprising because it's just more evidence of the same. Scientists report surprising evidence, ice increasing in Antarctic, not currently contributing to sea level rise. Right? So it has the skeptical valence, but it's new evidence. Right? Believer surprising versus skeptical unsurprising. Scientists report surprising evidence, Arctic ice melting even faster than expected. I say there's some kind of equilibrium with the melting at the poles. Scientists find still more evidence that global warming actually slowed in the last decade, kind of a skeptical conclusion, but unsurprising, we've had this evidence for quite some time. The prediction you would make if you left science curiosity out is that people would pick the news story that's most consistent with their ideology, whether or not it's presenting new evidence. And our prediction is, well, the science curious people, they're going to want to see this new evidence. Right? So here we see that the liberal Democrat, who's below average in science curiosity, only a 24% chance that he or she is going to pick the article that was contrary to his or her predispositions. Whereas the liberal Democrat who's above average in science curiosity, that person's 68% likelihood they'll pick the surprising skeptical over the unsurprising believer story. And we see the same thing happening. If you want, we can talk about the magnitudes of these effects, but the same basic phenomenon with the people who are conservatives. Right? And you know, I guess is, what does this evidence suggest about how you should try to communicate science? And really, I should just let you tell me what you think the potential ways we could use this information, if any. Right? But basically, to resist the pollution of the science communication environment. You know, and this is the best I can do, is maybe we can shift the curve. Right? Because people who are about a standard deviation above the mean, that's where you're seeing these kind of puzzling effects or surprising effects, that people are less biased politically, that they're probably one standard deviation or more above the mean in science curiosity. But maybe there's a way to write the science stories that provoke that same kind of appetite to want to be surprised in people closer to the mean of the population. I mean, it's a continuous, at least as we conceive it, it's a continuously varying disposition, science curiosity. So it's harder to excite it in the people who are lower in science curiosity, but it shouldn't be impossible. So why not just try to come up with even more effective ways to excite curiosity in the general population. I don't know, that's easier said than done or something. But I really don't know that much about how to make good science films. I just measure things. But maybe you can tell me what other ways you could use that data, use that dynamic to try to help people adapt to the polluted science communication environment. Right? So tell me what we should do. Who has thoughts on this? And meanwhile, you can see Pat. Maybe you know Pat, yeah?
I don't have a thought, but I'm wondering if in your research you included other additional factors such as B versus risk-taking or being comfortable in lifestyle versus... So those are the things that, additional factors that potentially could...
Yeah, but over time we have there are scales that measure sensation seeking, basically how much, do you go bungee cord jumping, or do you just prefer to sit at home and read a novel or something like this? There are measures like that. But
they're consistent with...
No, well, they generally, when we use them, they had no effect whatsoever. Right? So we've got a bunch of critical reasoning dispositions that all have the same signature of making the polarization get worse. Then we have these other kinds of personality traits. Maybe they're just bad measures of those things. They tend to be self-reporting. Maybe if we had better measures of them, they would explain these kinds of differences. But in our research, they just didn't seem to have much of an impact. I mean, for one thing, they're not distributed unevenly across the ideological spectra. Right? So if people are picking the positions and forming the beliefs that are consistent with their ideology, it must be the case that it has the same effect on people who are sensation seekers in both the right and the left. Right? They're not being drawn together. They're still being pushed apart. But we just didn't have... I don't know, maybe the measures aren't good. But there are other factors that matter, for sure. Gender, white males who are conservative tend to exhibit the effect that's even more extensive. There are other things too, and maybe there's some other explanation for this. Yeah?
In your inquiry, did you look at implications of age over a wide age range?
The age differences.
Yes.
Yeah, and they're a little... I mean, we found that if you took cohorts and you looked at science curiosity, it seems to go down a little bit as people are aging. But then as they got to be above 65, it was going up again. I mean, I just thought it was noise. Oh, well, so these are general population samples, but we... 18, it'd have to be an adult. So 18 to whatever, 100. And so there's not really a big correlation with age. And that's another one, too, that we haven't really found very big effects with. Yeah?
So how would you differentiate innate curiosity and science curiosity?
Yeah, I think, again, like I mentioned, that you have these kind of bad measures of science curiosity. But all the existing measures of curiosity use this self-reporting. They try to... Some of them purport to measure just curiosity in general, but they're really not very good measures. I think it is a problem if you don't have an object. Right? But what does it mean you're curious? They go, oh, what's in here, or something like that. I don't know if that's curious. But you're curious about science. Well, then I can kind of get a grip on it measurement-wise. But I would suspect that people who are curious about science, they're probably curious about other kinds of things too, like politics and what have you. In fact, I can tell you how much more likely a person who's science curious is to have gone to a gun show, like in the last year, right? Or to have read a book about religion. Well, it turns out that people who are curious about science, that they try lots of things. And I don't think that makes it... I'm not... Probably there's some general trait of curiosity that makes it more likely that people are going to be science curious.
The point of my question is that I think we're all born with some innate curiosity, and how can we get people to be scientifically curious so that they can actually evaluate...
Well, and see, it's an interesting... I mean, I think that's definitely right. That one implication would be that you want to try to be even better at promoting or conserving the curiosity that people have when they're in school, right? When they're in primary, secondary school. Because then, what? They'll be, in a sense, better citizens. it's surprising to think that science curiosity in that way is a more important kind of civic political virtue than actual science comprehension. Right? The science comprehension seems to be pushing people into the bad modes of reasoning as for democratic citizens. But yeah, that now it's not like we just thought of this yesterday. Right? I mean, for at least 100 years, I mean, John Dewey was very much aware of these kinds of issues, and he made the point that you need the science curiosity for people to get the benefit of science literacy. That the science curiosity sort of stocks your inventory of facts that you need to understand and helps you to focus in on the science relevance of different kinds of policy choices. But nobody's come up with really good measures for this, looking at science curiosity in schools to this day, or critical reasoning ones. They're also pretty difficult. So, I mean, yeah, that would be the project. It's been the project, you know, for at least 100 years. But now with better measures, maybe. So, anybody? Yeah.
Yeah, I'm curious about.
You're curious, okay.
And skeptical, maybe, about the narrowness of these bands, the red and blue bands for liberal Democrats.
Oops.
Is this all Democrats or just a subset of those that somehow were defined as liberal? Same question.
So what we do is we have, as I think I mentioned, the evidence, and you're thinking of stuff like this, right? And so these are, you know, these are 95%, yeah, right, they're 95% confidence intervals. We have a scale that we use to measure the political dispositions of the subjects. Basically, they just tell us on a 5-point scale how liberal or conservative they are. On a 7-point scale, how much do you identify with the Democratic Party versus the Republican Party? And those are very nice complements of each other. So you have an index, basically, but then it is continuous across the idea. Or it performs like a continuous measure. But when we model it, right, I might say, well, the same way that I showed you how we had that big statistical model of the covariance with the political issues of the gun control versus the skin cream. Well, I've got models for this. But I say, well, I want somebody who would say, I'm liberal and I'm a Democrat. I'm a conservative and I'm a Republican. Not that I'm independent, not that I'm extremely conservative and strongly Republican. Let's just pick somebody whose score would make him or her a liberal Democrat and a conservative Republican. The measurement error is just because it's there in the sample. I've got however many people here, probably about 300. But no, we're trying to use it as a continuous measure. And we're not picking the people who are extreme in their political predispositions and leaving out the middle. We're trying to model this as a continuous disposition. Yeah.
So where do conservative Democrats and liberals?
There can be, I could model that if you want. You know, conservative Democrat, probably somewhere near the middle.
In between those two?
Yeah. Well, I mean, the model would sort of constrain them to be in between the two if we're assuming these are linear kind of relationships. I could show you the raw data with dots and things like that, so you could say, well, that's the right way to measure it. Over here, yeah?
Yeah, you showed that these differences between those two groups kind of collapsed when you went from politically charged to less charged issues.
Yeah.
Did you see that same thing with the scientific curiosity where you had the offset of the two parallel curves? Did they become the same curve when you went to the medical x-rays or nanotechnology?
Oh, so we haven't looked as much at the range of issues. Like in this study, we just had we have these risk issues, and so picking out the ones that are politically contentious, the science curiosity is moving people in the same direction. We don't have as much information about some of these other kinds of issues, so I'm not sure, but I suspect that because the people, regardless of their political orientation, are basically reacting the same to them, that it wouldn't make as big a difference, but I'm not sure. Now, are they getting the right answer, too, is another, I'm not sure, you know, if they're, but polarization for its own, in itself, is something to worry about. Yeah?
I was just wondering why the slopes of the blue lines
I mean, it's here the slopes are probably the same. On there, we've got like a ceiling effect, right? So even the liberal Democrats who are relatively low in science comprehension, it's an easy one, right? They're more likely to get the answer.
My point is that there's no deflection in the slope of the blue lines.
That what?
There's no deflection in the slope.
Yeah, no, that's what I'm addressing. So, you know, there is going to be a ceiling effect. It's hard for people to get much higher than that, right? But I can show you, you know, as you do these things over and over again, you know, there's some noise, but you do see the kinds of ones where they're both going up at the same time. So if we go back to the, see if I have the climate change, something like this, on the both fracking and global warming, right, they're going up. I don't know if there's a significant difference in the slopes. I don't think so. On gun ownership, it's kind of flat, but sometimes we see the conservative one looking flat and the liberal one reacting. I think it's probably just noise. But also, there'll be ceiling effects. If a group, everybody in the group knows what the group position is, right, then it doesn't take as much for them to get it right. But the kind of experiment that I did, I think, is more amenable to the answering this question. Are the tendencies of people who have different kinds of political orientations equivalent in the kind of motivated reasoning? I mean, people are interested in that topic, and so you would do some huge meta-analysis to try to figure it out, all the studies like this. Yeah? More questions? Yeah?
So what is your answer to the question you ask us, or the group's answer? How do you more effectively communicate what you believe, at least use the correct answer to any of these politically charged conditions?
Yeah, well, I think that's difficult. I mean, there was another study we had. I was going to say, well, if you understand the concept of the polluted science communication environment, right, that the science communication environment would just be the sum total of influences and cues that people use to figure out what science knows, given that they can't comprehend it themselves. If you have the kind of pathology I'm talking about, where people are polarizing on facts and it's aggravated by the science comprehension, then something in those practices is being disrupted. One thing you can do is try to help people adapt by finding these other kinds of scientific reasoning dispositions that aren't affected, like curiosity. But you also might want to try to detoxify the science communication environment. So what kind of interventions would you use to try to disentangle the beliefs and the identities of people so they didn't have that incentive to try to conform the information to their identity? And so there was a study we had about that in here. But, you know, I think I like to say, you tell me, because these are all models of dynamics, that you're using lab studies, and in lab studies you sort of abstract from all the influences in the real world that are going to create noise, and so you can know exactly what's having what effect and you can control it yourself. But then you've got a kind of understanding of the issue that doesn't necessarily apply anywhere. Right? I'm confident that these mechanisms I'm telling you about are part of the problem people have when they look at science in the real world. But how you would adapt the experiments that show you can dispel it to real world conditions, I'm going to go to some place like Southeast Florida. We have a project there, Evidence-Based Science Communication Project, with four counties, Broward, Miami-Dade, Palm Beach, and Monroe, the Keys. And we help them use information like this to come up with communication strategies. But I just say, well, here's everything I know. It's very general. You're going to know much better than I am what kinds of things you might do to reproduce in your own environment the kinds of effects we get in the lab. So we turn them into scientists, right? You're gonna have better intuitions, make better hypotheses. Then we'll go out there and measure these things. Right? What they basically settled on was just social proof. Right? If people see people like them acting in a certain way, they tend to think that's the right way to act. And so show them that there are people just like them, and the relevant thems are probably four kinds of opinion formation groups. Make their stock their kind of vista of people doing things with the people who are like them, evincing confidence in the science by using it, basically. And then they'll think what you're doing with the climate adaptation programs that you're promoting is probably the right thing to do. If when they look up, all they see are people like them fighting with people who are like them, then they're going to say, well, that's an identity defining issue. They're not going to say it consciously, but they're going to engage the information that way. Now, we have people on the science filmmaking project. They make science films. You know, they might not even care that the science curiosity is having this interesting effect on information processing in politics. And they might care, but they're going to tell us what the good hypotheses are about how to engage people with science documentaries, because they're more likely to not understand that. Then we come to them with an experimental design and say, would you agree that this experimental design will generate information that you can use to help test the competing hypotheses you have? They might say, no, that's stupid for a reason, you know, 1 through 50. Well, okay, I'll try it again. How about this one? They go, yeah, if that one comes out this way or that way, then we would know something more. So I like to say, you tell me, even though it's a little bit irritating. You're very irritated by that.
There's two ways that you might do it. Okay. Number one would be to ease into the more politically charged subjects from more neutral topics, you know, sneak it up on. And then the other thing would be to find someone who presents the information in the films who's very charismatic.
Like Donald Trump.
Also identify.
Uh-huh. Yeah, no, I think those are good conjectures.
You have to find a way to incentivize the curiosity.
How would you incentivize the curiosity?
I have no idea.
Yeah, that's a good. Yeah.
What I'm capable of is telling facts are facts. Whether you care what the political agenda is, what's the famous movie of Jack Nicholson? He said, maybe you can't handle the truth. So you have to think about some people just don't want to believe.
Yeah, although I would say if you put it that way to them, they're not very likely to have engaged the information in the open-minded way you were aiming for.
Some right? People have an economic interest in it.
Yeah. Actually, it's kind of like that.
I think it's a challenge for you as a scientist to make a very simple test of each of these things to prove that this is either truthful or not. You know,
yeah. Well, so the kinds of issues that we're looking at, or the kinds of claims, are ones that are made about how people assess scientific information, right? So let's pit the identity protective reasoning up against the bounded rationality theory, a steel cage match, and see who wins. At that point, if you're doing your job well, you end up with a kind of collection of mechanisms that you can sell to people and say, well, these are probably this, is, and they're glad. You know, well, we were trying to convince everybody with better grades. Graphs, you know, that's not going to do it.
They're biased, and they want to be biased.
Maybe.
That's part of art.
But, you know, so, well, and then, but I can be very confident that we're doing that, and maybe overconfident, but I know that they need to know more. They have to do what we did in the lab to figure out what mechanisms are of consequence and which not. In the field to determine which plausible ways of implementing these kinds of policy prescriptions will actually work. And again, there's more things will be plausible than are true here about how to reproduce in the field what we observed in the lab. Right? Now, what you were saying?
Oh, I just think that a lot of people have
Economic interest. But isn't it a lot like what I was saying about the interest they have as a consumer voter? Really, you can believe anything you want. It's not going to have any impact on your... So I mean, you can hope that, in fact, your side wins because you have big investments in the coal industry or something like this. But really, as an individual, you're not making a big difference on that. People do have a stake, though. They have interests in fitting in with their group. Right? So we don't really see big income effects in these. I'm not sure that would be the right way to test your hypothesis. But I think they probably have pretty much the same interest. If climate change is happening and it's going to make the Earth uninhabitable, did you see the New York Magazine article in 100 years, then they probably have the same interest there. Most of the people we have here do. But yeah.
Is there an issue of learning versus unlearning things that are wrong? So as an example, the NRA is way out in front of gun ownership. They've been teaching that guns are good, guns are protective, and then if you come with some liberal factoid, they know it's wrong. So that's where it could...
Yeah.
It's sort of to address your question, maybe scientists have to get out front of the messaging, of the marketing of their own work and say, okay, global warming, here are the facts before the senators and the candidates get up there and say it's going to threaten your
Tell me what you think of this kind of attitude towards these studies. You have to figure out what information actually is of consequence to people. And the factual data, it's not really, because they're not in a position to control those things, they can't understand it. But what they're basing their decisions on is social proof. What are people like me doing? And the NRA actually isn't so much trying to batter down your resistance to a kind of free-for-all with guns with data. What it's doing is supplying you with a kind of vivid information about how gun ownership is connected to the way that you want to live. And actually, these laws that say you can stand your ground, you don't have to retreat before using deadly force in self-defense. The NRA sponsored legislative campaigns and referenda to get those on the books in 25 states. Those states already had the law that said that you didn't have to stand your ground. It's been like that majority rule in the United States for over 100 years. But the NRA recognized that people had forgotten all about this or didn't know. If they got these kinds of laws enacted, then people would start to attack the laws in terms that would clearly be culturally aggressive and assaultive to their base. Right? So they're kind of re-energizing their base. Not with new facts, but with more information about what people like you do and what the people who aren't like you think about you. And so the question then is, well, how do you actually give them the information that people like you don't have an identity stake in a policy like this? That those are... But I'm not sure if that's the right answer. Yeah?
So what do you think would happen if we change the angle a little bit, came at the general public from a social science perspective, and initiated our campaigns around implied bias, and
around what? I'm sorry.
Implied bias.
Okay.
The concepts that we come to the table with that are by definition biased, and if we then show that without loading it with issues of gun or abortion or whatever, the many, many issues that we have that do divide us, but we first stepped up and came to them from this place and said everything we're thinking comes from this place of culture, bias, gender, race, and so forth and so on.
Yeah. So, the question is really then, is telling people about these kinds of mechanisms a means of counteracting them?
Right. On the screen.
Yeah.
Oz is just this little guy back there.
Yeah. I think that people tend to be pretty good at recognizing dynamics like this in other people. And they might also realize that they're vulnerable to themselves, but it's really hard to catch yourself doing this, right? The kinds of mechanisms that are at work aren't readily observable to you through introspection. And so just to know about them doesn't necessarily give you a protection. There are lots of psychological mechanisms, and maybe knowing about some do make a difference and others don't. Here, if you tell people, be objective about this, because people are at risk of being biased in these assessments, it tends to make it worse. And what happened is that they were thinking, well, are you trying to, you're basically, you're saying the position you've held before now is biased. Or everybody, I'd have to admit that I was biased before. Everybody like me is biased. You're actually kind of raising the price in a sense of changing your mind. I mean, I don't think that that was obviously going to happen. People had to test this to figure it out. But it seems like just kind of informing people that these things happen doesn't do a lot of good. But I do think that the point, in a more general way to understand your point, that people have the same interest in an unpolluted science communication environment, whether they're on the right or the left. Because they're going to have different policy orientations. Right? The facts never uniquely determine what policy you should use. But no one's going to know what policy is going to promote their values if you have these kinds of dynamics skewing everybody's understanding of what the facts are. Right? Or sometimes, too, you have, say, something like the HPV vaccine. We did a study that showed that people were using tacit information about what other people thought to basically figure out their team's position on the HPV vaccine. And I think if you went to them and the parents and said, you know, you're thinking about this medical information that's relevant to your son or daughter's health in the same way that a baseball fan thinks about the umpire's call when the umpire has decided the last out of the game and they lose, the umpire was wrong. They wouldn't think that that was good, you know, that they'd be horrified to know that. They would want you to try to do something in their science communication environment that would protect them from that. And I think that that's true whether they're Democrats or Republicans. I think that there's something to be said for that, although, you know, how do you, you know, that's the program for you as when you run for president. A clean science communication environment, you know, people are worried about a lot of things. So, but I think that's right. Yeah. So, no, are we done?
We can take more questions. I don't know about your schedule.
Yeah. Well, I could do 10 more minutes.
Okay.
And anybody else, if we want to leave you, I won't be insulted. So, more questions? Maybe there aren't any more. Other people want to leave and go swimming. Yeah. Clients in this area, you try these things out and see. I'm asking. You see, in marketing, but you know, here's the problem: is that everybody could be concerned about the well-being of their children. If they have different beliefs about climate change, then they're going to have different beliefs about what kind of policy orientation is good for their kids. They believe in climate change because they have a certain political or cultural orientation. Then they say, well, you've got to do something because the well-being of our kids and grandchildren is at stake if we don't stop climate change. If you have the opposing orientation, you say, there isn't any climate change. And what you're proposing to do is going to basically disrupt the economy. And that's going to be bad for society. And my children and grandchildren won't have as good a life as a result. Their motivations are actually dependent on the kind of belief about the facts. So it's not that the Republicans or anybody else going around saying, we don't care about our grandchildren. You know, we'd rather be dead than not driving the SUV. You know, I've heard better red than dead, but better dead than red. But I've never heard better to drive an SUV or be dead. They think that their children's welfare is going to be hurt by these kind of crazy radicals who want to, using the pretext of climate change to try to attack the market institutions or industry or something like this. So I think before you could appeal to their common motivation for the well-being of their kids, they'd have to agree about what the facts are.
Whether you're looking at short-term, the economics of short-term, and what happens 100
Yeah.
So,
did people read that New York Magazine article about the uninhabitable planet?
So, I mean, if you're talking about as soon as 100 years from now,
yeah. Well, they said it's going to be horrible in 100 years, that we'll all be,
closer.
Everybody in this room will be dead.
Yeah, that's why, hanging on to the last.
But the point is, if you could get people to have a hook of something that they're interested in, and then based against that interest, they're hooked enough to recheck their thinking.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying at that point you get them to agree.
Yeah.
I'm saying if, I didn't even say global, you know, the climate change is for sure. I said, suppose some of those people are right.
Yeah.
I think we better do a second check on this because we want our kids to have the life we have 100 years from now.
Yep.
So, I mean, some sort of a message that is pinned against kids, looking at it at another time, looking long term instead of short term. Because there is a tendency, kind of, whether people are Democrats or not, to look at short term in our society.
Yeah.
And look at what I will have right now.
Yep. Yep, I agree. More questions? Yeah.
So I come at this as a scientist. So I have a physical scientist, if you will. So I have a little bit of a problem with the notions of the subconscious biases that all of us have as affecting issues like gun ownership and fracking. I don't know what the question was that you may have asked with respect to those particular issues. But actually, so I write a blog on global warming, and my most recent posts have addressed the issue of issues of what has science done for us already, and what can it do for us in the future. And I've started, I don't want to be pushed out. I have a habit of talking too much. But what has science done for us so far? So I said, okay, the telegraph has led, arose because we knew about the laws of electromagnetism. You send electric current through a wire, you wind it around the coil, and it becomes a magnet, and that's how telegraph began, or leading to the telephone, and radio and television communication. And most recently I talked about cancer chemotherapy and immunotherapy. And all these rely on the building up of a body of scientific knowledge that builds on the pre-existing knowledge that's already been gathered. And each one takes what's known and extends what is known by doing more experiments and coming up with answers. So we couldn't have done cancer immunotherapy 10 years ago because it relied on the Human Genome Project. The Human Genome Project, which sequenced every gene in our DNA, wasn't published until the year 2000-2001. Scientists have begun building on that information and working with immunology to come up. So these are just examples. And what I personally am trying to do, because I am a left-brain person and not a right-brain person, is writing articles that are attempting to show that here's what science has done for us already in this field. And here is what science has done for us already in this field. And here's what science has done for us already in this field. Show me how global warming differs from all the science that has underlain all those other accomplishments and achievements. They won't be able to find it.
But you're assuming then that the source of confusion or resistance on climate change is that people don't believe in science or don't trust science. I mean, here are two factoids.
Well,
I'll give you two factoids. These issues are empirical issues too. The institution.
I'll just say that I was stimulated to undertake this series of posts by the current administration.
Uh-huh.
Issue before.
But you see, like both groups, both sides, believe that their positions are consistent with scientific consensus. That's just another piece of information they have to get, the same as whether the Arctic ice is melting. They have to trust people's representations on this. Both sides, it's like going to war. Everybody says science, you know, God's on our side. Science is on our side. And they're using the same kind of reasoning that gets them confused about facts when they're trying to assess what the... And it's also, one more factoid. The General Social Survey, it's a survey that goes back about 50 years. They've had this institutional trust battery in it. So like 13 institutions, the press, Congress, the president, the Supreme Court, businesses, the leaders of churches, and science. Science has always been either first or second on the list. And it's the only institution whose credibility assessment has not gone down over this period of time. People on the right trusted science more than they trusted the executive branch when Reagan was president. People who are moderately religious, they trust scientists more than they trust the heads of the churches. Everybody says they love science. And everybody says, too, that they think we should be spending more on it. Now, they don't pay much attention. They're not going to really punish a congressperson or president who doesn't increase the funding for NSF. But if you think that the problem is that they're distrusting science, well, I think that's been tested. That's not what the issue is.
No, I think the issue is the misrepresentation of global warming as a separate identity. And what communication, one thing that science communication, I think, can try to accomplish is to show that it's all common and that the scientific method and the way that science builds on itself and generates new useful information is universal and is not segregated into global warming.
But all I'm saying is that there's a theory, there has to be a theory about what the dynamics are that result in this kind of polarization to say, well, the answer is to do this kind of thing. And that's an empirical issue, too. Right? And that's an empirical issue. Right? And so and it's a perfectly plausible hypothesis about this. But you know, I think it's been looked at. The currency of our exchange should be empirical evidence. And everybody has intuitions about why these things are the way they are. The intuitions are diverse and not consistent with each other. Right? And so we need to test it and be scientific there too. That's the big point about these kinds of methods.
Awesome. Yeah, I think that's one of the big challenges from everyone who's curious about science. And so maybe for all of you who come here regularly, maybe you can take it upon yourself to bring one person who hasn't come for these and see what this is about, scientific curiosity and all that. And the next cafe we have will be on September 16th, and the Connecticut State entomologist, Kirby Stafford, will be coming
a big overlap between this one and that one, I guess. I would have done something else.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Fit on your same scale.
Well, the nuclear, yeah.
Same.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Although nuclear was the big issue that had these.